Are we good? Good morning.
Good morning.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Trying a new style.
Yeah.
As you can tell, I've been told that I look good.
Yeah.
So.
Amen.
I'll take your word for it. Anyway, I want to start by reading you from Proverbs. Chapter 3, verse 5 says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and do not lean on your own understanding." This is not an easy thing to do. You know, and as I was thinking about this, the reason why this is not an easy thing to do is because we're humans, and humans are full of emotions. Sometimes when the Lord gives us a promise, we're like little kids waiting to open a birthday present. Or on Christmas morning, trying to get what that present is. You know, we start shaking the box. I wonder what's on it. It's a lump of coal. But other times, when we are facing a difficult situation, we get anxious. And then we start thinking, oh, God, when is this thing going to be over? I can't take it anymore, you know? It's not easy. However, it's not impossible. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, I want to read to you verses 8 through 10, but I want to read from the Message translation. It says, "We don't want you in the dark, friends, about how hard it was when all this came down on us in Asia province. It was so bad, we didn't think we were going to make it. We felt like we'd been sent to death row, that it was all over for us. As it turned out, it was the best thing that could have happened. Instead of trusting in our own strength or wits to get out of it, we were forced to trust God totally. Not a bad idea, since he's the God who raises the dead."
Yeah. Right.
"And he did it, rescued us from certain doom, and he'll do it again, rescuing us as many times as we need rescuing."
Yes.
So Paul here talks about the God who raises the dead. Why would Paul make such a statement? Well, perhaps it's because death is the end of things, is the final event in a person's life.
Mm-hmm.
But you have to look at it from a natural perspective, because spiritually, we know that that's not the reality. Did God raise the dead one time? No. He did it plenty of times.
Yeah.
Genesis chapter 17, this is when God promised Abraham a son. But when he did that, what did Abraham do? He started laughing. And he laughed because he was 100 years old. Sarah was 90 years old. So he's like, how can I have a child at such an old age? But then what happened? Well, Genesis 21, the Lord visits Sarah, and he did to Sarah as he had promised. So Isaac is born. But then in Genesis 22, God asked Abraham to offer Isaac as a burnt offering. So Abraham went to do as the Lord had commanded. But right before it happened, the angel of the Lord called to him and told him not to do it. Why did Abraham do this without hesitation? Well, for two reasons. One, God had commanded him to do it, but also because he believed that if God gave him a son at such an old age, that he resurrected Sarah's dead womb, he could bring Isaac back from the dead.
Right.
He also raised Jairus' daughter in Mark chapter 5, verse 41.
Mm-hmm.
He raised Lazarus in John chapter 11, verses 43 and 44. And he raised Jesus.
Yes.
But that's not the only thing that he did more than once. In Acts chapter 1, Jesus is taken up into heaven after he's resurrected. But before that, in Genesis 5, verse 24, Enoch was taken.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Enoch walked with God, and he was not, for God took him. Or in 2 Kings chapter 2, verse 11, Elijah went up by a whirlwind into heaven.
Yeah.
Here's another thing that God did more than once. In Exodus chapter 14, verse 21, "Then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and the Lord drove the sea back by a strong east wind all night and made the sea dry land, and the waters were divided."
Right.
Where did it happen again? 2 Kings chapter 2, verse 8. Then Elijah took his cloak and rolled it up and struck the water, and the water was parted to the one side and to the other, till the two of them could go over on dry ground. He was with Elisha at that time.
Mm-hmm.
So there are many more examples in the Bible of things that God did more than once, because if he did it once, he'll do it again.
Yes.
If you want to look more into recent events, just look at other people's testimony.
Yeah.
You know, I spoke about this not too long ago. We share our testimony so that others can be reminded of what the Lord can, wants, and will do for them.
Yes.
We need to trust God.
Yes.
We need to put our trust in him.
Yes.
You know, there's a story about a man that falls off a cliff. And as he's falling down, there's a branch and he hangs onto it. And as he's hanging onto the branch, he starts yelling, "Help! Is there anybody out there?" And then he hears a voice, "I'm here. Who are you?" "It's me, God." "Lord, what should I do?" "Let go of the branch. Let go of the branch." And there was silence for a moment. And then you hear, "Help! Is there anybody else up there?" No? He didn't trust God. But as Paul said in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, rather than trusting our own strength, we should totally trust God.
Yes.
And that's not a bad idea.
Yeah.
All right.
We need to trust God, and we need to let him lead.
Amen.
Wednesday night, when Pastor was giving his sermon, he talked about dancing.
Yes.
And I want to close with this. You know, in dancing, there's always one person that leads, because if both try to lead, it's going to be chaos. So we should be dancing with God,
yes,
but we should let him lead.
Yes.
He wants to dance with us, even when we think we shouldn't dance.
Right.
Come on.
Amen.
We need to let God be like Patrick Swayze in Dirty Dancing.
Yes.
And let him say, "No one puts my baby in a corner." That's what I got for you. With that, I open the floor for questions. That's kind of my catch for you, yes, Alex.
Sword, and it occurred to me that sword is S word.
Mm.
It's the spoken word. sort of wanted to cry, but she didn't want to cry, and she just hugged me because I think she didn't know what else to do, which I think is amazing because, you know, they're so small, but, you know, God still moves on them too.
Yes.
And I spoke, I don't know, a few services ago about the next generation.
Exactly.
And how we have a unique opportunity to instill in them what we know so that they don't have to unknow religion.
Right.
That, you know, that we had to do.
Right.
So that they can walk in this. And God has been dealing with me, seems like everything I'm reading or things that I'm hearing, and I don't know if it's because I'm getting older or if it's because I'm a new grandma, but, you know, God uses things in your life, people in your life to talk to you. He's talking to us all the time.
Yeah.
I'm so grateful that I can hear him. And what he has been talking to me about is the youth. And in Psalms 127, 3 and 4, it says, "Behold, children are a heritage from the Lord, the fruit of the womb a reward. As the arrows are in the hand of a warrior, so are the children of one's youth.
Yes.
Happy and blessed and fortunate is the man whose quiver is filled with them."
Mm-hmm. service. What are they going to do to you like that? So I said, Lord, you're so blind. I said, over there, they're rebuilding the bathroom for this house, and they're going to have vacation Bible school over there, and they're headed back here on Tuesday, so.
Amen.
Yes.
Praise God. Amen.
Amen.
The worship team next Sunday night will be in the inner city at New Life Center, down on 23rd Street, just across from Drake Park. Pray for the worship team as they go beyond the walls and fulfill the calling of the Lord. I was over there yesterday talking to Pastor Jamel, who's been here for Tom Stammen functions, and known that brother for years. He's doing God's work in the inner city. He was saved at a Bill Wilson ministry in Bronx, New York. He gave his heart to the Lord in that ministry where Bill Wilson, I don't know if you guys are familiar with him, that they bust in 10,000 kids a week and minister to them. But Jamel was one of those 10,000 a week to get ministered to at that time. And grew up in Oklahoma because he was fostered in by a couple down there because his mom couldn't take care of him in Bronx. They helped him through Bible college, and now is an ordained pastor doing the work of what he was called to do, which was the same thing that brought him to Christ. And even yesterday, he was ministering to 40 kids in the inner city of Des Moines here. I love this man. I've done ministry with him before. But I told him I would pray for their church because they are facing the inner city needs of people. There's a core group of people that are hungry for God, and then there's the inner city situation of the drug abuse, the darkness, the strife, and the things that are going on that they're totally engulfed in all the time, trying to reach out to these people that don't want to be reached. So I'm just praying for them, for New Life Center this morning also, that the Holy Spirit move on to them and draw them in, that they would be ministered to. And that the things that are seeking and drugs and alcohol and other things that will not fill that void, that God-shaped void in them, that the Holy Spirit will reach out to that area right now and touch them also.
Amen. 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 Praise the Lord.
Yeah. Anyone else? Okay, well, yes, Peter.
I don't want to take this too long, so the Lord's been dealing with me lately a lot about complaining and how we sabotage ourselves because we don't bring the sacrifice of praise. And we have a pretty difficult situation at work. Most of our team is actually secretly looking for other jobs. But you know how it is at work. You don't typically tell people when you're looking for a job. But I feel like the Lord had been telling me a while back. I've been praying, seeking him about why things were so difficult. And he was showing me that the door was closing. So I've been sharing that with people one-on-one. And it's really encouraged a lot of people. And then almost to a bad extreme where I've got 10 people IMing me at once on Teamworks or Link, because they just need to talk about how their day's going because just so many things are happening. And we had a guy that's he's not a believer, he's from India, and he had a very I remember, if you remember when Tom was here, he prophesied over me about having compassion because of the things that had happened.
Right.
And right around the turn, this guy had the exact same thing happen to him from our manager that I had under a previous manager, and I was able to have compassion for him. Share with him how I'd be praying for him as he goes into this meeting with this guy, because he isn't sleeping. He's terrified now of our boss, and just a lot of things happen. But the one thing I think the Lord wants me to share is when you feel like complaining, a lot of times you sabotage what God's trying to do in your life because you start getting into that realm. And what you really need to do, whether you feel like it or not, is just start to thank the Lord.
Yes.
Start praising him, and that'll turn everything around. That's why Easter Day is so vital. Is because we have that time. You know, a lot of times when we have worship here, we don't, we start to get into the presence of the Lord, but we don't have time to really get into it as much. But at Eastern Gate, we're doing it for a couple hours, and I have to be honest with you, I've had a horrible week. Friday was a hard day as well, even though I was in class and not at work. And it unfortunately I had to leave Eastern Gate early, but it wasn't until after the first hour that I really was starting to feel it. So let me just encourage you, to seek God, praise him, and thank him.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Okay, well, let's stand. Let's thank the Lord this morning. Father, I thank you for bringing us in your presence today. We thank you, Father, for your word. We thank you for all your promises. Lord, you are a God. When you do something once, you will always do it again. And it is because of that that our faith grows, Lord, knowing that we are going to receive that which you have promised. Father, we lift those up that are in need for healing, those that are in need of some sort of relationship restoration, financial restitution, Lord. We put them all in your hands, because we know, Lord, that you are going to satisfy all of those needs. Father, we thank you because you are our healer, you are our comforter,
you are worthy,
you provide for our every need. Lord, we pray for those that are going out of this walls to go and spread your word in this world. We lift them up, Father, that every person that you put in their path,
hallelujah, Lord,
is illuminated by your
word. Hallelujah, Lord.
So let's go ahead and speak the word.
Will you now provide us again that your people may rejoice in you?
Disease to
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I want to thank my brother Roberto for leading worship last week while I was gone. It was a good time with my wife and family. Hallelujah. Sometimes you just got to do it. Just got to do it. It was good. Next time we go out, we'll probably let you know where we're going stuff. So if you want to come out and burn some marshmallows and stuff, we'll let you know. Okay? I don't want to announce it on Facebook because I don't want to say, hey, there's nobody at our house. Come and get whatever you want. Okay? So.
Well, you got guard dogs.
Yeah, and they'll be with us barking at every rabbit 10 miles away. Right, Cindy? Hallelujah. They're still getting used to my son-in-law. He's just, and my one daughter. They just love barking at him. I don't know why. There must be some kind of spirit on him or, no, what? I didn't say that. Hallelujah. We had a good time. We had a good time. Even though it rained, we still had a good time. Cause every knee will bow, every tongue confess, Jesus Christ, He is Lord forever. Every knee will bow, every tongue confess, Jesus Christ, He is Lord forever.
Praising His name, I just can't stop. praise his name, Jesus. Can't stop praising his name, I just can't stop. Praising his name, I just can't stop. Praising his name, Jesus.
Everybody sing it out.
Can't stop praising his name, I just can't stop. Praising his name, I just can't stop. Praising his name, Jesus. Can't stop praising his name, I just can't stop. Praising his name, I just can't stop. Praising his name, Jesus. Can't stop praising his name, I just can't stop. Praising his name, I just can't stop. Praising his name, Jesus. He's the Prince of Peace, rising morning star. Jesus Christ, he is Lord forever. He's the Prince of Peace, bright and morning star. Jesus Christ is Lord forever. Can't stop praising his name, I just can't stop. Praising his name, I just can't stop. Praising his name, Jesus. Can't stop praising his name, I just can't stop. Praising his name, I just can't stop.
Down. I can hear the sound of the river coming down. I can hear the sound of the river coming. It's coming down. I can hear the sound of the river coming down. I can hear the sound of the river coming down. I can hear the sound of the river. I can hear the, see the sound. And I can hear the sound of the river coming down. I can hear the sound of the river coming down. I can hear the sound of the river coming. It's coming down, it's coming down, it's coming down. I can hear the sound of the river coming down. I can hear the sound of the river coming down. I can hear the sound of the river coming. It's coming down. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your sons. Sons and daughters will prophesy. You sons and daughters will prophesy. Sing it out. You sons and daughters will prophesy. 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 It's being poured out. It's being poured out. It's being poured out.
I can hear the sound of the river.
It's coming down, coming down, coming down. Hallelujah, Lord. Let us shout. Shout it out. Hallelujah, Lord. Shout it out, Lord. Shout it out, Lord. Release, 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 Lord. Release, Lord. Release, Lord. Release, Lord. Release, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. It's all about you, Lord. It's all about you, Lord. Our sons and daughters will prophesy. Our granddaughters and grandsons will prophesy, Lord. Release, 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 release. Oh, speak it out, church. Speak it out, church. Claim your children. Claim your grandchildren right now. Lift their names up. Lift their names up. Hallelujah.
Up to you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. This Tammy was holding her grandbaby Friday night. She didn't have the words to speak because she was so young. But she had a war cry. And it wasn't a cry baby cry. She just, ah! It wasn't a cry. It was like, I don't know what to say. I don't know what to speak. Just grandma's singing and praising and shouting, ah! She just looked at her like, am I supposed to be doing this? And you know what? She was supposed to be doing that. I tell you what, it was fresh anointing. Peter took pictures of it. You'll see it on Facebook.
Hey, can I speak something out the Lord's given me?
Do it.
So, I don't usually do this, but I feel like the Lord just gave me a picture of somebody here that should have raised their hands for prayer, but they didn't. And this person feels like set apart. They feel like they've been betrayed. There's at least three, maybe more people conspiring against them. They feel like they've been separated and set apart, and they're lonely. And the Lord's just showing me that you're like a leaf, and that without the source of life, a leaf withers and it dries up and it dies. And the Lord wants this person, I don't know who it is, to know two things. One, you have to stay plugged into Jesus to stay alive. John 15 tells us that, you know, Jesus is the true vine and the Father is the husbandman. Every branch in him that bears not fruit, he prunes, and he purges, and every branch in him that is in him, he prunes that it might bear more fruit. This person, whoever you are, I believe that the Lord's telling me that he is purposing you to be set apart, not for all the pain and hurt that it's causing you, but that so his plan and his good work can be fulfilled in you, so that the glory of God can be manifested in your life. But if you unplug from Jesus, if you blame him for what's going on, you're going to wither and dry up and die, not physically, but spiritually. And he sees everything that's happening. He sees these people that have been plotting against you, these people that have been talking behind your back. And he sees that they pushed you apart. But he wants you to stay plugged into him because he's the life. So, you know, he sees what's happening. He'll bring about restoration in the situation. But what he's doing in you is to manifest his glory through your life.
Awesome, awesome. Thank you. Hallelujah. As that soaks in, whoever it is, I think it's more than one person that's facing this right now. Let's turn to the King. Let's turn to the Lord and just seek his face and worship him.
Mercy.
mountain above, the praise of your people.
I saw the Lord,
yes, Lord,
seated on his throne.
Yes, Lord.
He was clothed in glory, exalted high, and the train of his robe, it filled the temple.
Say too much, I'll be crying like a little girl here in a minute. God is so awesome. Oh, Jesus. And he loves us so much. This God that we've been praising and worshiping, the God of creation, the one that created everything, he came and gave himself for us.
Yeah.
So that we could be free.
Yes.
So that we could love life and enjoy life and experience life. Not to come and fulfill a bunch of rules and regulations, but just to be free to love him and love one another.
Yes.
And I'm telling you, this is better. You know, I know sometimes it makes some people uncomfortable because we get a little excited, but man, what he's done.
Yes.
you know, you can kick the dog or kick the cat, but it just doesn't get rid of those anxious and upset feelings. Sometimes a dog needs to be kicked. All the time, cats need to be kicked. But Jesus just needs our worship.
Yes.
He just wants our worship.
Yes.
And he just pours back so much. You can't outgive God. I don't know how much you put into it. He just pours it back on us. He is a God of grace. He's a God that doesn't demand anything except that we believe. And because of that, everything is good. Even when it doesn't look good, it's still good. Amen. Let's give the Lord a big hand clap this morning. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Praise God. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. Let's give the worship team a hand clap, too. They did a great job this morning. Thank the Lord. Amen. Praise God. Appreciate them being sensitive to the Holy Ghost and allowing the Spirit to minister through them. Praise God. Amen. I'm just getting over my freak out here. I'll be fine. Praise God. I appreciate so much the testimonies, and thank you for your prayer requests, for trusting us to share those with the Lord. And God is faithful, amen, when we believe and cast our cares upon him. Amen. Because he does care for us. Praise the Lord. And the young people, as they leave, can be dismissed. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. They don't wait for me anymore because half the time I forget. Praise God. But thank you for all of the visitors that are here today. We appreciate you being here and sharing this Sunday morning with us and the Lord. And we're grateful for your presence. It just amplifies and magnifies the Lord. And everybody has a part to play. And God never overlooks any of us. Amen. So God bless you and be blessed in the Lord. Praise the Lord. So let's just move right into this. I want us to get started. Well, I want to go to Romans chapter 6. And let's read verses 1 through 7, Mike. And then we'll jump to 23. But I want to read Romans 6, 1 through 7. And then verse 23. Praise God. Appreciate all the testimonies again. I love it when I get confirmations and in the testimony and preliminary parts of the service, which I don't really like to call it that because it's as much a part of the service as anything else is. In fact, sometimes it's the best part of the service, I got to say. Amen, because God's given the opportunity to speak through his people, and that's what he really wants to do, be expressed. Amen. We are the body of Christ, and he wants to be expressed through us. Praise the Lord. So, amen. What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid, how shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? Know ye not that so many of us as were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into his death? Therefore we are buried with him by baptism unto death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. For he that is dead is freed from sin. That'd be a good scripture to underline or, yes. Amen, memorize or something. Right. Praise the Lord. He that is dead is freed from sin. Praise the Lord. Verse 23. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Amen. So I guess the first thing we need to do is understand what dead to sin really is. What it does and what it doesn't mean. It does not mean that you no longer sin. This may come as a revelation to some of you really, really spiritual people, but for the rest of us, it's just a reality. Amen. Dead to sin does not mean we are no longer tempted.
Right.
We get tempted every day. Sometimes we yield to that temptation. Sometimes we don't. But let's look at it this way. Galatians chapter 2, verses 20 and 21. I'm crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live. Yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not frustrate the grace of God. For if righteousness come by the law, then Christ is dead in vain. Praise the Lord. Being dead to sin means that you no longer are identified as a sinner. Amen. As long as you were in Adam, the first Adam, you were a sinner. You didn't have to do anything to be a sinner. You were just born a sinner.
Exactly.
That little baby back there, as beautiful and as much as the family loves that baby, it's a sinner. Hasn't done a thing. It's just innocent, but it's still a sinner because it was born of the flesh. Jesus said, don't marvel at this, but you've got to be born again. You must be born again. Because once you're born again, you're no longer a sinner. You're now in Christ. You are dead to sin and alive unto God.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
And that beautiful part about that baby back there is it's sanctified by grandpa and grandma.
Yeah.
Amen. In other words, she's not saved because of them, but she will be. And in the meantime, she gets the favor of God and the blessings of God because of them. It's where the Bible talks about, you know, do not be unequally yoked. But if you're married to an unbeliever, don't leave them because that's their cover. That's what's going to bless them is the fact that you're a believer. God's going to bless them and honor that faith that you have and bring that person then to Christ.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Amen. So we are now alive to God. Our identity is not a sinner. Our identity now is that we are alive to God, that we are joined to Him, to the second Adam, instead of the first Adam. Praise the Lord. The second Adam, Jesus, died on the cross. And we died with Him. Praise God. And the only way that we can enter into that experience is by faith. You can't do it by works. You can't do it by trying to be a really good person. We want to be good people, obviously. But you're not going to get saved. You're not going to be in God simply by being a good person.
Right.
Amen. We just trust the Lord. We enter into that experience by faith. Faith is simply this. It's me, in this case, saying amen to what God already said is true. It's the same for everybody, every one of us. Faith is not, we don't have to conjure up and work up some great energy force of some kind. That energy is already here. It's Christ in me, the hope of glory. And likewise for you if you're a believer. Even if your life is chaotic and you don't really have the, you know, feel like you have the spiritual connections that you've heard some people talk about here. We all live our lives, amen, in rhythms.
Yes.
Amen. And sometimes we're with the beat.
Yes.
And if you're like me, sometimes not so much. Praise the Lord. We saw a young man on the way here to church this morning by the bus stop right up here on 42nd, and he had some moves. I mean, this kid, he was, you know, I don't know, he was breakdancing, but he never touched the ground. But I told Sally, the bus may pass right by him because he was really in another world. Amen. But I don't really have that same rhythm. Amen. That's why I just do the slow dances. Praise God, because I can't screw him up too bad. But Jesus, our relationship with the Lord is one that is based on His work and on His work alone. Amen? It's our step of faith to agree that God is telling the truth regardless of what we might think or how we might feel. God's word is still true. What God said about the situation, about me, about you, about anybody else, is still true whether I feel like it or not, or whether you feel like it or not, whether you look at me and say, oh, he don't act that saved. The decision was already made. It was made by Jesus, and your opinion doesn't amount to anything. Amen. Everybody is allowed an opinion, but everybody doesn't get to have their own facts. Praise the Lord. You can have an opinion about anything you want to, but the facts still remain the facts. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. So, it's a choice of our will that over time, it results in our thoughts and our feelings lining up with those choices. You choose the Lord, you put your faith in Him, you just simply agree that what He said is the truth. That's how you get saved. That's how you do everything in this Christian life. And eventually, if you continue to do it, like we confess the word here, I know people look at that and they go, what are they talking about? We're just saying what God said. We're just repeating what God said. And so if you do it long enough, just like when you talk about, I am the righteousness of God in Christ, if you continue that confession, eventually you'll begin to realize That's the truth. That's the reality. Amen? It's just like, remember when you were a kid, they may not do this anymore, computers and everything, but when I was a kid in school, they used to have these flashcards, 2 plus 2 is 4, 4 plus 4 is 8, 8 plus 8 is 16, that's as far as I go, praise the Lord, but you know what I'm saying? And you kept seeing that over and over and over until pretty soon 4 and 4, you just know it's 8. You don't have to write it down, you don't have to count the little digits on the 4 to make sure you got 4 there, and then 4 more is 8. No, you just, bang, you just know it because you've had it shown to you so many times. And that's where the renewing of the mind comes in, is by just agreeing with what God says and continue to agree with it, regardless of how you feel about it or what you think about it, until eventually it becomes a reality. That choice that you made to act on faith and based on what God said suddenly becomes a truism for you. I mean, it's just settled for you so that you know. Amen? Yep. Let's go look at this at Romans chapter 6 and verse 11. Did I ever read that one? Okay, good. Because I sometimes talk and forget what I actually said. I've said this before, but it's still true. I just keep talking and hoping that at some point I'll say something. So there's a lot of things there that don't mean a whole lot, but eventually I might say it. Likewise, reckon ye also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So likewise, reckon ye also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Now, counting ourselves dead to sin doesn't make it true. Amen? It's just like the professions of faith that we have, the confessions, the proclamations that we make, that we do before every service, about healing, about deliverance, about prosperity, all those things that are biblical that God has said. Counting ourselves dead to sin doesn't make it happen any more than just saying those things that are on the screen make it true. It's true because God said it was true.
Right.
It isn't true because I didn't say it. That makes it happen. It's true simply because God already said it, and I'm just agreeing. Therefore, because God says it is true, we count it to be so.
Yes.
We just say, yay and amen. God said it. It has to be the right truth. It has to be the only truth. Amen. But the problem with most Christians is that they don't see themselves as being dead to sin and alive unto God in Christ. Amen. So they work hard, they labor, they do everything they can to protect themselves from sin, and they do that by building walls of laws and rules around themselves. And since they've been convinced that the Christian life is, trying hard to obey God's commands, they keep trying harder. They keep giving themselves more rules. They keep giving themselves more demands of what they have to do or what they should do. Look at John chapter 8, verses 32 to 36. 32 through 36, please. And ye shall know the truth, and the truth will make you free. They answered him, we be Abraham's seed, and we're never in bondage to any man. How sayest thou, ye shall be made free? Jesus answered them, verily, verily, I say unto you, whosoever committeth sin is a servant of sin, and the servant abideth not in the house forever, but the Son abideth forever. The servant doesn't abide forever, just the Son. If the Son, therefore, shall make you free, you'll be free indeed.
Yes.
That's what Jesus did when we got born again. We were servants of sin simply because that was our identity. But Jesus freed us from that identity and gave us a new identity. Amen. The righteousness of God in Christ. He became sin that we might become the righteousness of God in Christ. Now, we want to believe everything Jesus says, and everybody's saying, oh man, we got to keep this commandment, we got to keep that commandment. No, you're not made righteous or acceptable or godlike by what you do, not by anything you do. You are made a child of God, an offspring of God, the righteousness of God, by faith in Christ, by simply saying yes to what Jesus has said. Praise the Lord. Amen. So, the Son sets us free. And the truth is, what He frees us is, He frees us up to look to God as our life and walk with Him in grace.
Yes. Yeah.
You can judge me all you want. My granddaughter was always saying, don't judge me. You can judge me all you want to. But God has already judged me in Christ and declared me to be righteous, so that's my life now.
Yep.
My life is not necessarily what you always see or what I'm, you know, always manifesting, amen. My life is in Christ. And the challenge for me is not to try to be perfect. The challenge for me is to try to remember and identify with the fact that I'm in Christ and Christ is in me and I'm walking in grace.
Right.
I'm walking in the favor of God, not based on me, but based on Jesus. Hallelujah. We've become one with Him. I said last week, we didn't just get Christ in us, the hope of glory. We got in Christ. You can't separate the two. We are one.
Yes.
Amen. And it's not this. It's what's inside here. It's who I really am.
Yes.
We are spirit beings with a soul. That's intellect and emotions and so forth. That is housed in a body. But the body is temporal.
Yes.
The body isn't what God judges. God is judging our soul. Our spirit was dead to God until it was born again in Christ, and now it's acceptable to God, even if the body here that houses that spirit isn't perfect, it still screws up. God isn't dealing with this body. He's dealing with our spirit. And He declares this spirit to be perfectly righteous. I'm telling you, if I drop over dead right here, right now, I'm going to be with the Lord. You can deal with the flesh. You can haul it out and call the air, whatever you got to do to get rid of it. But I'm going to be with the Lord.
Yes.
And it ain't going to be a long trip either, because He's right here.
Yes.
Heaven is not millions of miles away. It's just another dimension. It's just we can't see it because we're still in the flesh. So you have to see it with eyes of the Spirit.
Yes.
But it's a reality nevertheless because God said it is. Amen? So Christ's death freed us from being controlled by the law.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Yeah, that ought to be some good news for anybody here. Praise the Lord. And the reason is because Jesus perfectly fulfilled the law through His perfect life, perfect death, and perfect resurrection. Anything other than that is thumbing your nose at God and saying, I can do this, like the Jews did, you know, when they were given the Ten Commandments. All these things we'll do, Lord. We can handle it. And before Moses got down the mountain, they got a golden calf, and they're running around naked having a big Bacchus party of some kind. Amen? Praise the Lord, right?
Yes.
They couldn't do it, but because they said they could, God held them accountable.
Yes.
If they'd have said, we can't do it, we need a Savior, the Savior would have been there.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. So when by faith we enter into this new relationship with God through Christ, we are taken out from under the law system and placed under the grace system,
yes, Lord,
which is that Christ has fulfilled the law. No more demands on us, not even the Ten Commandments.
Right.
You say, well, that can't be right. Well, it is right.
Yep.
The Ten Commandments.
Yep.
Doesn't mean we shouldn't be moral people. Doesn't mean that we shouldn't covet or all those things. But that shouldn't be our focus. Our focus should be Jesus.
Right.
Someone was talking about this latest stuff in the news and how that, you know, we ought to be dealing with it as pastors and saints and so forth and so on. Look, I see the news. I try not to watch it very much because it's depressing.
Yeah.
But I know the world is in bad shape, and I know it's only going to get worse.
Yeah.
Amen? But God has given me a message, and I think any minister for that matter, and you as well. And that is good news.
Yes.
Not the news. I'm not here to preach the news. Turn on Fox News or CNN or something. You'll get all the news you want and then some. I'm here to present the good news. Hallelujah. Amen. And that good news will overwhelm the bad news every time. Whatever happens in the world is going to happen. Amen. I'm not going to change it. And you're not going to change it. What we're going to do is escape. Now, this is not an escapism message, but it's the idea that if we trust God, God is going to provide. Amen. And that's the message people need to hear.
It is.
They know the world is a mess.
Yep.
They know it looks scary out there because of all the things that are going on. But hey, there's been wars and rumors of wars. It's just telling us we're getting closer and closer to the day of the Lord.
Yes.
But that's not something we should be scaring people with. Look, I was saved in a holiness Pentecostal church in East Texas, and I know about revival. I know what we called revival. And most of the time, we brought some evangelist in that would show us mushroom clouds and famines and this and that and tell us, if you don't come to Jesus, that's going to happen to you. Try to scare you into a relationship with the Lord. Well, I saw plenty of people come into the altar, but I also saw them go right out the back door a week later as soon as the fear had worn off a little bit. Fear, God never gave us the spirit of fear, and I'll be the last person who's going to try to preach fear.
Right.
I'm not doing it. I don't care what anybody says. I don't care if they think that's cowardice. I'll tell you what's cowardice is to get on the internet and Facebook and start putting a bunch of junk out there about everybody as if everybody is categorized in that group. That's the only problem I've got with it, although I don't do it because I'm not cyber here. But I'm just saying there's a lot of good in Facebook and the internet and all of that stuff. But it also gives you an excuse to get on there and just make blanket statements about everybody as if you actually have that evidence. I, my wife does it, and she'll say, do you see this or hear that? And I'll, yeah. It's like an obscene phone call.
Yeah.
It's just somebody calling and irritating, and but you can't respond unless you want to get on there and just have a big bicker.
Yeah. Right.
Well, anyway, that praise the Lord. Hallelujah. See, that's what we do when we get mad. I don't go on Facebook. I just come up here and rant for a few minutes. But look, I'm not saying I don't love people that get on there and do that. I do. But I'm saying it's not logical that you can know every pastor, that you can know every church, that you can know everything that's going on in those places, and that everybody's out to deceive or something and mess with people. No, our purpose, not just mine, but all of us, our purpose is to bring good news to people that are hurting, people that are already frightened, people that already don't have an answer, amen, and are looking for something, amen, that can deliver them. And the only thing that can deliver them is not fear, is not intimidation. The only thing that can deliver them is the love of God that is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. So we need to just say, hey, well, you know what? It's awful, but God loves you and He's got a plan. Hallelujah. And you don't have to succumb, amen, to everything that's going on in the world. Praise the Lord. Okay, I'm over it. Hallelujah. We need to be led by the Spirit. Right? Who the Son sets free is free indeed. So we, and He says that He has sent forth His Spirit in the world to lead us and to guide us into all truth. Amen?
Yep.
We have the guidance. So let's look at this in Romans chapter 8, 1 through 10. Romans 8, 1 through 10. Jesus went unto the Mount of Olives, and early in the morning He came again to the temple, and all the people came unto Him, and He sat down and taught them. I need Romans 8. I'm sorry, Romans 8, 1 through 10. I think I scared him. I didn't mean to. There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, that's us, God, sending His own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin, condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Now that word carnally minded, we often get the idea because of religious teachings that that means some kind of immorality or, you know, really bad behavior, drunkenness, you know, revelry, something horrible that we would think is awful bad. It's not what he's talking about. To be carnally minded is simply to think rationally, intellectually, humanly.
Right.
Amen. Not thinking like God, not agreeing with God, not saying amen to what God says, but trying to sort it all out and figure it all out for ourselves is to be carnally minded. They that are after the Spirit. Okay, so I'm sorry, Mike, I'm messing you all up. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Because the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. So then, they that are in the flesh cannot please God. But ye are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if so be that the Spirit of God dwell in you. Now, if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. And if Christ be in you, the body is dead because of sin. How many here are believers? Well, don't raise your hand. But if you're a believer, your body's dead as far as God's concerned. If Christ is in you, the body's dead.
Right.
Why? Because of sin.
Right.
But the spirit is life because of righteousness. Your spirit is alive to God because of the righteousness that God has imparted to you.
Yes.
Amen. So, now let me go back and I'll just pick up on what Roberto said. Roberto was saying some things that I had said Wednesday night. I'm going to tell you the whole thing here. See, there's a huge difference between a man or a woman walking in legalism and one's walking in the freedom of grace.
Yeah.
I mean, it's like two different worlds. Being led by the Spirit of God is not fearful. Being led by the flesh is motivated by fear. You have laws. Why do we have laws? Because otherwise people will do bad things. Does it make them good or moral because they don't do them? No, they don't do them most of the time because of fear of punishment. Right? You don't want to go to jail. You don't want to have all the fines or whatever it is. So that's the way law works. Law works by fear. Grace works just the opposite. Praise the Lord. Being led by the Spirit of God and not fear. That leads us to intimacy.
Right.
When you no longer have the law between you and God, now there can be intimacy.
Right.
And then from that intimacy becomes, it leads us into a dependence on God.
Yes.
You won't depend on somebody you don't know, that you don't trust, that you don't have any history with, right? You'd be crazy if you did because you don't know what they'll do. But having this leading of God and this guiding from God leads us into a state of intimacy, which leads us into a place where we can actually depend on God. Well, we get so close to God that we trust Him. We know that whatever I have need of, He's going to provide it. He's going to take care of it. Amen? The Holy Spirit leads and guides us into all truth. Amen? Now, here's what Roberto was referring to. The word guidance, at the end of that word is dance.
Yep.
And God is like wanting us to dance. Walking with God is like dancing. You think, oh, God, here he goes. This is Joyce Meyer or something. No. Be patient here for a minute. When two people try to lead, nothing feels right. Nothing flows. Everything's jerky. Everything's uncomfortable. But when one person relaxes and lets the other lead,
yes,
both bodies begin to flow with the music.
Yes.
Amen?
Yes.
One gives gentle cues. A little squeeze here, a lean this way, whatever. Amen?
Yeah.
And it's as if the two become one body.
Yes.
The dance takes surrender and willingness and attention from one person and gentle guidance and skill from the other.
Yes.
When you see G in guidance, think of God, followed by you and I.
Yes.
Praise the Lord.
Yes.
God lets you and I dance.
Yes.
So let God lead.
Yes.
Yes.
Amen.
Right.
Trust Him. Lean not to your own understanding, and He'll give you life.
Yes.
Not rules, not regulations, not laws,
life.
Praise the Lord.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Okay, so now it's the time to enter into this dance.
Yes.
You know, we've been like Jacob wrestling with God all the time when God was just saying, relax, I got this.
Yeah.
He had to knock Jacob's thigh or hip out of joint so that he depended on God.
Yes.
Because he was too busy trying to lead.
Yeah.
He was a deceiver. But when he came face to face with God in a place called Peniel, which means face to face, he said, I won't let you go until you bless me. And God said, I'm just changing your name from Jacob, the deceiver, the trickster, the manipulator, amen,
yeah,
to Israel. And the exact translation of that in that particular context is God fights.
Yes.
You don't have to fight anymore.
Right.
You can just relax and let God lead. Amen. He goes before us in the battle. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Amen. So we need to just, it's time to enter this dance. It's time to come into the newness of life in the Spirit so that you can bear fruit for God.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. You see, the problem with so many of us is we've lived under legalism, and deep down, we're not convinced that God wants us to enjoy life. We're not convinced that God wants us to have pleasure in life. So we become reluctant then to pursue any kind of intimacy with God, because we figure all he's going to do is tell us no anyway. You know, so we don't really want to get too close, because he's liable to tell me no. You know, he doesn't want me to have fun. He doesn't want me to enjoy life. He wants me to be morose and grim and just really going to get this religious stuff together. But ever since the Garden of Eden, the devil has been on a crusade to paint a picture of God as anti-pleasure. He's done a pretty good job of it, especially considering the fact that that Eden, the very word Eden, means pleasure.
Yeah.
God created a garden of pleasure for Adam and Eve.
Yes.
And ever since then, the devil's been trying to convince us that God hates pleasure. God hates good. God hates fun. God hates a good time. Praise the Lord.
Yeah.
Most Christians have been told, don't do this, don't do that, don't go here, don't go there. And they've heard it so many times that they've come to think that God is this cosmic killjoy.
Yeah.
That he's just waiting to mess up your plans.
Yeah.
Dan and Tammy just left for the fair. We need to be praying for them right now. But you know, I mean, I've taken this to an extreme, but the fact is, I've sat in church services where that would have been a very evil thing. Because you know why? They got stuff on a stick there. They got beer tents. And they got people scantily clad because it's like 95 and the humidity is out of this world. Now, I may seem like I'm being facetious, but the truth is we take these things and we just add on to them.
Yeah.
We start seeing everything as bad now, because if I'm enjoying it, God must be unhappy about this.
Yeah.
God surely couldn't be liking this. You know, we're having too much fun. It's like my mother. God bless her, and she is with the Lord. But she was a worrier, and she felt obligated. She had 6 kids. She was busy worrying all day long. I have to be worrying about them because I know they're going to screw up. And if things got to going really well, she'd say, something bad is going to happen. I just know it. Things have been going too well. God, what a horrible way to live. Now, she'd come to know the Lord and saved, and she's with the Lord now. But I'm just saying, a lot of us live our lives that way. Things are going along good, and we're thinking, oh, my God. Go to bed that night and you're thinking, oh, Jesus, the grandkids are on vacation. This one's gone somewhere. This boy's off to college. What the hell is going to happen? Something terrible is going to happen because things have just been too good. It can't get too good in Jesus. Hallelujah. He said, I'll take care of it if you'll just trust me. Cast all your care upon me because I care for you.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. God is not the cosmic killjoy.
No.
Amen. He wants us to enjoy life. And that more abundantly. Praise the Lord.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Lord.
Praise the Lord. Nothing could be further than the truth than to think that God hates pleasure, or that God's against pleasure. You know, God isn't Santa Claus. There's always that difficult transition when the kids get to be a certain age and they start coming home and they're saying, you know, is there really a Santa Claus, Grandpa, Dad? And, you know, is there really an Easter Bunny and all that stuff? And it's weird how kids are, because some of them will believe in the Easter Bunny for a long time after they quit believing in Santa Claus. And I never could quite figure that out. I'm thinking a big rabbit's bringing eggs and candy, and I don't know. But anyhow, I'm just saying, Santa Claus, you better not shout, better not pout, better not cry. I'm telling you why. Because he's coming to town. Hallelujah. And after making his list and checking it twice, he's going to know who's naughty and who's nice. Praise the Lord. Now, have you ever thought of Santa as a legalist? But he is. He is. And it gets worse, because this Santa, this same legalist, knows when you're sleeping and when you're awake. He knows when you're bad and when you're good. Now, Santa the legalist is bad enough, but Santa the stalker is disturbing. He's peeking in your windows to see when you're asleep and when you're awake. But we transfer that to God. There, you'd be surprised, maybe not, how many Christians think of God in those terms. God is not a stalker, and God is not a legalist. God is a God of favor and of love. Praise the Lord. God is not like Santa. Look at it. Psalms 103, verse 8. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and plenteous in mercy. More than enough. Where sin abounds, grace does that much more abound. Hallelujah. Amen. All right, Psalms 145 and verse 9. God wants His people to love Him, not be afraid of Him. When we talk about the fear of the Lord, it's just an awesome awareness of God's greatness and God's power. It isn't fear like cowering that God's going to get me. The Lord is good to all, and His tender mercies are over all His works. He's good to all, and His tender mercies are over everything that He does. Praise the Lord. Isaiah 30 and verse 18. Praise God. Hallelujah. Therefore will the Lord wait that He may be gracious unto you, and therefore will He be exalted that He may have mercy upon you. For the Lord is a God of judgment. Blessed are all they that wait for Him. God is a good God. Amen. And He delights when we enjoy His creation. I mean, have you ever... I've talked about this before, but those of you that hunt or fish or just like to sit on the back porch or the deck and look out at the birds eating all your stuff, and there's pleasure in that. I mean, it's just, there's a peace, there's like a symmetry, there's a rhythm, there's something going on there that just makes everything seem right. It's the way it ought to be, you know? That's because God provides. God created this for our pleasure. Amen? He wants us to enjoy and experience this creation. 1 Timothy chapter 6 and verse 17. I'm just giving some scriptures here because we started out with this idea that faith is just simply saying yes to this. This is what God said. This isn't what I'm saying. I'm not trying to give you my interpretation. I'm reading just exactly what the Word says. And your responsibility is simply to say, I agree. Yes. I choose to believe this. Amen. Yes. Now, you can choose to believe whatever you want, but this will still be the truth. Right. Charge them that are rich in this world that they be not high-minded, nor trust in uncertain riches, but in the living God, who giveth us richly all things to enjoy. That's not an indictment against people that have money. It's a reminder to those of us whose incomes fluctuate and do other things. But God gives richly to everybody to enjoy. Everything that's out here is for our enjoyment. Yes. What happened that we think that some might be for fun and some might be evil? Now, obviously, I understand there's immorality and there's bad behavior. But don't confuse that with what God has provided or how God looks at us. Right. Amen? God is good. Enjoy life. The pleasures of life are in Him. Yes. That's why all through the Old Testament, you can look it up for yourself. Eat the fat. Drink the wine. Have a party. That's what God says over and over and over under the Old Covenant. Yeah. When there was a law, when there was legalism and everything else. He's still saying, enjoy life. Yes. Look at the Hebrews. I mean, my goodness, every few months, there is another celebration, right? Yes. That God instituted.
Right.
Party. Yeah. Like it's 1999. It's God's plan. It's God's purpose. You know what I'm saying? Do you understand what I'm saying? He's saying, enjoy life. You get this once.
Yes.
Heaven's going to be great. It's going to be better, but it's not this.
Right.
These relationships will not be the same.
Right.
Enjoy it here. Love it here. We're going to love eternity. We won't be missing this when we're there. Please, believe me. But this is what we have now.
Yes.
And we're supposed to be enjoying it.
Yes.
And thanking God for it. Amen?
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. Malachi chapter 4, verse 2. Now, I'm going to read this out of the Message because it makes it a little clearer. Or you could also do it in the Amplified. But here it is. Malachi chapter 4, verse 2. The sun of righteousness will dawn on those who honor my name, healing, radiating from its wings. You will be bursting with energy like colts, frisky and frolicking. Now that sounds like freedom to me. Hallelujah. Sounds like my wife up here when we were worshiping.
Yes.
Come on. I knew she really wanted to get loose, but, you know, she was next to me, so she just didn't. But you understand, that's God.
Yes.
God is saying, here's the way it's supposed to be. When you believe me, I'll rise up in you like the sun. Yeah, but he's talking about Jesus here. With healing in his wings.
Yes.
And you will be renewed. And you'll go skipping and jumping like a... Anybody ever see a little colt?
Yep.
A baby horse?
Yep.
They are fun to watch because they're just kicking and flipping. And they're just... It's like all of a sudden they realize they got legs.
Yep.
And they can do anything. And they just go nuts.
Yep.
And God says that's the way our lives should be.
Yes.
We should have such a sense of freedom and love that we are feeling, we're being continuously healed, not just physically, but emotionally,
yes,
mentally. Yes. So we're not under this great burden of, oh God, what is he expecting from me today? God is expecting you to enjoy your day. He's expecting you to jump around like a baby colt and have some fun, to love life and experience it to its fullest. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. The devil's a liar.
Right.
Amen. And he'll tell you that this scripture, it doesn't apply to you though. It might work all right for Nathan, but it doesn't apply to you. God's given up on you. God's given up on you because you failed so many times. You may not even be saved because you struggle so much. Oh, it got quiet in here. Praise the Lord. I've heard all this. Most all of us have. David experienced that relentless accusing, the accusations of the devil. And it just eroded his hope.
Yeah.
It just sucked the life out of him.
Yeah.
Psalms 44, verses 15 and 16. My confusion is continually before me. The shame of my face hath covered me. For the voice of him that reproacheth and blasphemeth by reason of the enemy and the avenger. Satan is the accuser of the brethren.
Right.
And David is saying, he's back again.
Yep.
He's constantly bringing up things in my past. Something that I did 5 minutes ago. Something that I did 10 years ago. I'm ashamed. I'm just so embarrassed and ashamed that I want to cover myself. Because of that voice, that lie of the enemy that reproaches and blasphemes. And says that God will have nothing to do with you anymore. That God doesn't want you. That God has given up on you. That you're not going to be saved. You never were saved. You never can be saved. Because you just screw up too much. Well, I got news for you. David was a man after God's own heart. And you'd be hard-pressed to find anybody that could screw up any more than David could. But God didn't ever turn his back on him. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Let me tell you a little story. There was this reporter. This is a true story. And he was covering some things in Mexico. How many of you know the Mexican police are known for their corruptness? We were coming back from Baja, from Ensenada, down the Baja one time when I was still in the service, years ago, 50 years ago practically now, 45. And it was early in the morning, and we'd been drinking, but we weren't drunk. I mean, I suppose that's always, you know, relative. But, you know, we were driving and we were coming back, trying to get back to Camp Pendleton. And this kid driving, the roads are purposely, I think, confusing when you get close to the border there. And so we got on a road and we knew we were going the right direction, but this cop pulls us over and tells us that we were going the wrong direction on this road. Well, we knew we weren't because there was cars going in front of us. And he didn't stop them. So he pulls us over and he tells us, you're going to have to go to jail tonight because the magistrate won't be there until 9 o'clock tomorrow morning. So we got a brilliant idea. Well, maybe we could just pay you the fine and you could give it to the magistrate. Well, he thought that would be all right. He could probably do that since we were gringos and on our way back to the base, and he didn't want to create any problems for us, so he took our $23.40 that we all four had together, the four of us, and promised to give it to the magistrate, and I'm sure he did, and we went on our way. Well, that's just a personal experience, but I mean, you know, there's corruption everywhere. I'm not just saying that, but I'm just saying that has been an issue in Mexico itself. So this reporter is down there reporting on corruption within government there. So him and the cameraman are driving along, and they come to an intersection, and there's a policeman standing there, and he waves him through this red light. The light is red, but the cop waves him on through. So he drives through, and then the cop stops him and gives him a ticket for running a red light. True story. So the guy is really burnt up about this, and he's seen this happening over and over and over. So he goes to a friend of his who is the head over the Mexican media, a very powerful person in the government, amen, and he tells him, look, this is crazy, you know, they're telling me to do stuff, and then they're giving me tickets and fining me and everything else for doing it after I've been told to do it. So he says, look, here's the deal. This media expert or head in the government gives him his business card. And he said, the next time it happens, just show him that card. So sure enough, a couple of days later, he gets pulled over, and they tell him his taillights are out or something that was not true. And he pulls out this card, and he hands it to the cop. And the cop freaks. He puts it back and says, you're free to go. You're free to go. He was scared because this guy had some power. So I'm saying all that to say this. We've been bullied long enough. And it's time to pull out our I Mean Business card,
yes.
Hallelujah, that reminds the accuser of who we are and who we know.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. So when he comes trying to deceive you or intimidate you or lie to you, you need to get out of free jail card, amen, and flash it in front of him and say, hey, I am in Christ. I am alive to God and dead to sin. I don't want to hear any more of your lies. Praise the Lord. Maybe you've forgotten who you really are. Maybe you never really knew who you are. In either case, I've got good news for you, the new you.
Yes.
You're dead to sin and alive to God in Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Let's look at this. This is the last one of the testimonies that we're given. Ezekiel chapter 47, verses 3 through 9. Praise the Lord. And when the man that had the line in his hand went forth eastward, this is coming out of the throne of God. This is the vision that Ezekiel had. He measured 1,000 cubits and brought me through the waters. The waters were to the ankles. And he measured 1,000 and brought me through the waters. The waters were to the knees. And he measured 1,000 and brought me through the waters were to the loins. Afterward, he measured 1,000, and it was a river that I could not pass over, for the waters were risen, waters to swim in, a river that could not be passed over. And he said unto me, son of man, hast thou seen this? And then he brought me and caused me to return to the brink of the river. Now when I had returned, behold, at the bank of the river were very many trees on the one side and on the other. Then said he unto me, these waters issue out toward the east country and go down into the desert and go into the sea, which being brought forth into the sea, the waters shall be healed. And it shall come to pass that everything that liveth, which moveth, whithersoever the river shall come, shall live, and there shall be a very great multitude of fish. Because these waters shall come thither, for they shall be healed, and everything shall live, whether the river comes.
Yes.
Praise the Lord.
Yes.
So my word to you this morning is dive deep into that river.
Woo-hoo!
The river of your identity
yes.
in Christ. Praise the Lord. It's the antidote to shame.
Yes.
It's the antidote to guilt.
Yes.
It's the antidote to the lies of the devil. It's healing.
Yes.
And it's your identity in Christ.
Thank you.
By His stripes, you were healed, not just physically, emotionally, spiritually, in every realm. We need to celebrate it. We need to celebrate it every day. We need to live life to the fullest. And that way we honor God. That is the gospel truth, and that's good news. Hallelujah. Give the Lord a hand clap this morning. Praise God. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. So any others of you that may be going to the prayer, we will have a prayer line. Going to the fair, we'll have a prayer line for you here on the way out. Praise the Lord. Amen. No, go. Enjoy. Have a dog on a stick. Have a turkey on a stick. Have anything you want on that stick that's legal. Praise the Lord. Enjoy it. Amen. God wants you to be blessed. God wants you to know that He wants you to be pleasured with this creation that he's given. Amen. He's a good God. Don't let anybody tell you the difference. Amen. Give him another hand clap. Praise God. Amen, amen. Okay, thank you again so much, visitors. Appreciate you being here. Be sure and shake hands with those if they're new people. Forget the others, the old people. You just ignore them. Let them know we appreciate them being here and how much God appreciates them taking time out of their week to say something back to the Lord like, thank you, Jesus. Amen. God bless you all. You're dismissed in Jesus' name. Have a great week in the Lord.